On November 21st, 2016, news helicopters from around the globe converged on the Panama Canal to capture history. The transit of USS Zumwalt, America's most advanced warship. At $4.4 billion, she cost more than a nuclear aircraft carrier. This 15,000-ton destroyer was built to strike targets 100 miles inland. A revolutionary electric drive generated power for weapons that didn't exist yet. But now, just 5 weeks after commissioning, Zumwalt wasn't moving. Saltwater had leaked into her propulsion bearings, drowning her engines. She drifted helplessly between the canal walls. Tugboats rushed alongside, fighting to prevent her from crashing into concrete while tourists filmed from the banks. Now, the destroyer, designed to be invisible on radar, had become the most watched vessel on Earth. At the turn of the century, the Arleigh Burke-class destroyer had become the centerpiece of the U.S. Navy's surface fleet. Designed in the final years of the Cold War, this class combined powerful radar, long-range missiles, and anti-submarine systems in a tough, all-steel hull. Even after the Soviet Union collapsed, these ships adapted to new missions, having been battle-tested in the Persian Gulf, Mediterranean, and Western Pacific, firing missiles in combat, intercepting ballistic threats, and escorting carriers through contested waters. As the geopolitical focus shifted, so did the Navy's priorities. With regional conflicts, coastal missile batteries, and urbanized shorelines now posing a different kind of threat, planners envisioned the next generation of surface warships would need to operate close to hostile shores to support ground forces and strike inland targets, all while evading radar and surviving concentrated attacks from smaller, fast-moving boats. In the late 1990s, planners launched the DD-21 program, a 21st-century land attack destroyer. The design called for a ship larger than the Burke's, but harder to detect, with advanced 155mm long-range guns. As the program's scope widened with the new millennium, following a major defense review, the program placed a larger focus on an ambitious plan that combined stealth, advanced firepower, and cutting-edge electronics in a single hull. Extra plans called for a fully electric propulsion system, generating enough power for future high-energy weapons. Extensive automation to cut crew size from 300 to just 95 sailors, and sensors integrated into the ship's structure to minimize radar signature. The result would be unlike anything the Navy had operated before. The Zumwalt class, named after Admiral Elmo Zumwalt, the youngest chief of naval operations in U.S. history. By the mid-2000s, the United States planned to build 32 of the largest and most technologically advanced destroyers ever to enter frontline service. When Zumwalt first emerged from the yard, her size alone set her apart. At 610 feet long and more than 80 feet across the beam, she displaced roughly 15,600 tons, larger than many World War II cruisers. She also had a unique shape. Its sides sloped inward above the waterline in a tumble-home profile, a form once seen on early 20th century warships, but revived for one reason: to make radar waves glance away rather than bounce back. Her sharp, wave-piercing bow cut through seas cleanly, reducing spray and wake that could give her position away. The deckhouse was built from composite materials, paneled in flat, angled planes to deflect radar. All masts and antennae were enclosed, with no protrusions to catch a signal. Even the heat from her engines was vented and cooled before leaving the ship, while isolated machinery dampened any vibration that might betray her presence. The result of this unique mix made this 15,000-ton warship show up on enemy radar as nothing larger than a fishing boat. Mounted forward on Zumwalt were two 155mm advanced gun systems, each designed to fire the long-range land attack projectile project. This rocket-assisted GPS-guided shell could strike targets over 80 nautical miles away, delivering sustained and precise bombardment in support of forces ashore, hitting command posts, air defenses, or artillery batteries deep inland. Compared to cruise missiles, the LRLAP promised more shots per mission and a lower cost per target, giving the ship a way to project power far beyond the coastline without exhausting its missile magazines. Along her hull edges, there were 80 Mark 57 vertical launch system cells that could fire a range of missiles, from Tomahawk land attack, SM-2, and SM-6 for air defense, and even ship-to-submarine weapons. To top it off, two 30mm gun mounts covered the close-in fight against small craft. Below decks, the integrated power system could produce 78 megawatts of electricity, enough to power the ship and all her weapons. The planned automation reduced the crew only to around 140 sailors, instead of the originally planned 95, supported by a planned air detachment, still barely half that of a Burke-class destroyer. A flight deck and enclosed hangar could operate two MH-60R Seahawks or a heavy-lift helicopter, while a stern bay launched small boats for boarding or special operations. Every element was intended to deliver the Navy a ship decades ahead of its time, able to strike from the shadows, take on any target, and survive in waters where no other destroyer could go. On paper, it was the most advanced surface combatant ever built. Translating the naval design into actual steel would prove far more complicated. In the early planning stages, the Navy expected each Zumwalt-class destroyer to cost in the neighborhood of $1.4 billion, a figure that assumed a production run of 32 ships, spreading development costs across a large fleet. However, since every major feature of the design was new, from the tumble home hull, the composite deckhouse, the integrated power system, the peripheral vertical launch system arranged along the ship's sides, and most importantly, the advanced gun system, manufacturing them demanded specialized materials, unfamiliar shipyard techniques, and entirely new supply chains, each adding to the schedule and pushing costs higher and higher. By 2008, with costs climbing and other priorities pressing, Navy leadership reconsidered the entire plan. After calculations, it was decided that the Arleigh Burke class, still in production and already proven in service, could be built in larger numbers for far less money. That same July, the Navy announced it would cut Zumwalt procurement from the original 32 to only two ships, with a third one added later. This critical decision drove up the price of many unique components even more. By the time the first of her class, USS Zumwalt, was christened on October 28, 2013, she was already the largest destroyer, as well as the most expensive ever built by the Navy. Cost had climbed past $4 billion per ship by the mid-2010s. Additionally, plenty of the core technologies were still not fully mature, and some even faced uncertain futures. Nonetheless, by late 2015, after years of design work, cost overruns, and construction delays, Zumwalt was finally ready to leave the yard. On a gray December morning, she eased away from Bath Ironworks under her own power for the first time, ready for sea trials, with the dark Atlantic stretching ahead. Inside the Combat Information Center, displays flickered to life as radar sweeps began. On the bridge, small navigation teams monitored for progress, engines humming steadily through the new electric drive. Through it all, every turn, every acceleration, every system check was recorded, logged, and heavily scrutinized by Navy evaluators. On December 7th, during builder's trials off the coast of Maine, a call for help broke the steady rhythm of systems checks and maneuvers. A nearby fishing vessel had reported its captain was in distress, suffering severe chest pains and in urgent need of evacuation. Zumwalt was one of the closest ships. A bridge team quickly plotted a course and brought the destroyer around, closing the distance through cold, gray swells. Once alongside, the crew lowered a rigid-hulled inflatable boat into the frigid water. The small craft's crew sped toward the fishing boat, spray freezing on their gear as they came alongside. Minutes later, they returned with the fisherman, who was quickly transferred to the ship's medical space, where Navy corpsmen worked to stabilize him for further treatment ashore. From there, the trials continued well into the following year, with refinements and adjustments made along the way. On October 15, 2016, Baltimore's Inner Harbor filled with the sound of a Navy band tuning up. That morning, under a clear autumn sky, the Navy's newest and most advanced destroyer, the gray of her composite superstructure standing out sharply against the brick and glass of the city's skyline, was about to be officially commissioned into the service. For this very special occasion, crowds gathered early, lining the pier and the surrounding walkways. Sailors in crisp dress whites moved through the crowd, guiding guests toward the ceremonial platform. Guest of honor Navy Secretary Ray Mabus spoke of Admiral Elmo Zumwalt Jr., the ship's namesake, recalling his reforms as Chief of Naval Operations and his push for a modern, inclusive Navy. Also, there was the ship's first commanding officer, Captain James Kirk, manning the rails alongside some of his crew as the national anthem played. After a short ceremony, the ship officially joined the active fleet. Cameras flashed, applause broke out, and the officers and crew of USS Zumwalt stood ready to begin her service. For those who saw her that day, Zumwalt was the future of the American fleet. She was sleek, advanced, and ready to serve. Even her captain, James A. Kirk, expressed, quote, "Zumwalt is today a technical marvel. When deployed, our nation will have a multi-mission destroyer with the stealth and the combat power to take on the most challenging missions." But inside the Navy, unresolved questions lingered. Barely a month after Zumwalt joined the fleet, attention turned to her most distinctive weapon, the pair of 155mm advanced gun systems mounted on the bow. They were designed around a single purpose-built round, the long-range land attack projectile. Originally the ship's signature capability, these rocket-assisted GPS-guided shells promised a level of sustained fire support no other Navy ship could match. But in the autumn of 2016, the numbers behind that promise began to tell a different story. LRLIP had been priced for a fleet of 32 ships and mass production runs. With only three hulls in the class, the ammunition order shrank to a fraction of its original size. That change sent the per-round cost spiraling to nearly $800,000, an exorbitant amount within reach of a Tomahawk cruise missile, a weapon with greater range and a far heavier warhead. For a system meant to be a cost-effective alternative to missiles, the comparison was impossible to ignore. In November 2016, the Navy made the call. The long-range land attack projectile would not move forward into production, leaving her two advanced gun systems without any usable ammunition before the ship had even completed her post-shakedown workups. That same month, with the news of LRLIP's cancellation still fresh, Zumwalt, Kirk, and her 140-person crew began their first operational transit toward her new home port in San Diego. The route took her through the Panama Canal, a heavily trafficked waterway that demands precise control of a ship's engines and steering. On November 21st, 2016, while passing through the canal, saltwater from the cooling system leaked into bearings for the main propulsion motors, causing them to overheat and seize. The sudden loss of propulsion left Zumwalt adrift inside one of the most confined and unforgiving maritime choke points in the world. As canal tugboats took position alongside to prevent her from striking the walls or other vessels, the sleek destroyer, fresh from her commissioning ceremony, with the smell of fresh paint likely still inside her walls, now moved only under tow. From there, she was taken to Balboa, a port on the Pacific entrance to the canal, where Navy technicians and civilian engineers worked to diagnose the failure and plan repairs, including a partial dismantling of her propulsion system. By the end of the year, Zumwalt had spent barely a month in commission and already carried two heavy blows. To the Navy, these quick, successive events were clear warning signs about the risks of building so much new technology into a single ship. While Zumwalt sat in Balboa under repair, the rest of her class was still in the pipeline. The second ship, Michael Mansour, had been launched 5 months earlier and was tied up at Bath Ironworks for fitting out, her combat system still incomplete. The third, Lyndon B. Johnson, had yet to see her keel laid. The headlines were sharp. Newspapers and defense outlets ran the same comparisons. A $4 billion destroyer with no rounds for its main guns. Lawmakers pressed for answers on the cost, asking why the Navy had accepted delivery of a ship whose signature weapon was unusable. Criticism came from outside the Navy as well. Analysts pointed to the way the program had stacked first-of-its-kind systems from the hull design to the electric drive into a single platform, multiplying the chance for delays and unexpected costs. Others questioned whether the tumble-home hull, so central to her stealth, would be as seaworthy as conventional designs in heavy weather. Journalist Sebastian Roblin wrote, quote, "Traditionally, warships are tailored to perform specific missions, but the cutting-edge Zumwalt has been a ship in search of a mission." The Navy had three massive destroyers under construction or recently delivered, with no clear place for them in established fleet doctrine. The advanced gun system had been conceived to support Marines storming a beach or Army units operating near the shore. Without affordable ammunition, that role evaporated. In December 2017, the Navy formally redefined the Zumwalt-class mission. Now, these aimless and expensive vessels were set to become blue water surface strike ships, optimized for engaging enemy warships and delivering long-range missile attacks against high-value targets. This decision highlighted that the Navy's strategic focus was shifting once again. By then, China was building a modern fleet at an unprecedented rate, from new destroyers, cruisers, and even aircraft carriers, backed by land-based missile forces that could hold U.S. ships at risk across the Western Pacific. In a conflict over Taiwan or the South China Sea, American surface ships would have to operate far from shore to survive and still be able to strike high-value targets deep inside contested areas. That requirement matched the emerging conventional prompt strike program. A joint Navy-Army effort, CPS was developing a hypersonic boost glide weapon capable of traveling more than 1,700 miles at speeds above Mach 5, carrying a conventional warhead with extreme precision. For the Navy, finding a platform for such a weapon was a priority, and the Zumwalt class, with its vast electrical capacity and open deck space, was the ideal candidate. Initially, engineers explored fitting the hypersonic weapons without removing the 155mm guns, but later studies showed that replacing at least one advanced gun system mount was the most practical solution. By March 2022, the plan was finally public. Zumwalt, Michael Mansour, and Lyndon B. Johnson would each receive a battery of CPS missiles in the bow. The Navy expected the first installation before the end of the decade, but work began sooner than many anticipated. The shift gave the class a mission that played to its strengths. Hypersonics would allow them to engage time-sensitive targets, command bunkers, missile launchers, or warships in port from outside the range of most enemy defenses. Operating alongside carrier groups or as independent surface action units, they could threaten high-value assets across the Pacific in ways that no other surface combatant of any kind could match. By 2024, preparations were underway at Ingalls Shipbuilding to remove Zumwalt's forward gun and fit the missile tubes. For the first time since her commissioning, she was on the verge of a capability that matched the scale of her design, and a mission that the Navy clearly needed. USS Zumwalt sat in Pascagoula, Mississippi, in the final stages of a transformation that had been years in the making. At Ingalls Shipbuilding, her forward 155mm advanced gun system, once meant to deliver long-range shore bombardment, had been removed. In its place were four massive launch canisters, each capable of holding three conventional prompt-strike hypersonic missiles. When complete, the ship would carry a battery of 12 weapons, able to hit targets more than 1,700 miles away at speeds above Mach 5. The January 15th report from USNI News confirmed that the work was nearly finished. At the same time, the second ship in the class, USS Michael Mansour, was preparing for a Western Pacific deployment. She still carried her original pair of advanced gun systems, but her future was set. Once she returned from deployment, she would follow the same path as Zumwalt, trading her unused guns for hypersonic launchers. According to the plan, the third ship, USS Lyndon B. Johnson, had also entered her own integration phase. In the summer of 2025, Michael Mansour was sighted in Yokosuka, Japan. Her visit to one of America's key forward bases is no coincidence, as she prepares to take over her role in the area. Now, a Zumwalt-class destroyer could be positioned close to potential flashpoints. In the years to come, the arrival of one of these ships in a contested theater would carry a very different implication. Hypersonic strike capability was already within range. Projections call for all three ships to carry operational CPS missiles before the end of the decade. After years of cost overruns, technical setbacks, and questions about their purpose, the Zumwalt class now had a mission that matched their scale.